So I'll quickly share with you my 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Actually, we don't have time for all that. Let's go to just chapter 9. Chapter 9. I've actually never struggled with money since the day I got saved. That's my testimony. You might be different. Not once. Since I was 16 years old. I've not always made a lot, but I've always had enough. Amen. Sometimes the Bible says we learn to live in need, and we learn to live in abundance, and it's okay. It's okay if you just have what you need. The Word of God says if you have food and clothing and roof over your head, with these things you should be content. And so there is a sense of like, I'm content, but then I also want to be a blessing to others. And so, two things that I've learned to do, and I really want to encourage you in this morning. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 9. Look at this. Verse 6. The point is this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So the principle is this. If you sow a lot of seed, you are going to get a bigger harvest. If you sow a little bit of seed, you're going to get a little harvest. If you sow no seed, you're going to get no harvest. So that's the point. The point is this. Whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Paul's talking about a natural principle. And whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one, everyone say me. That's you. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, I love this because, I would say to you, and I never, if I ever feel like someone, like if I'm out of church service, and I've been at lots of church services, thousands of church services, and if I ever feel like a compulsion, like I feel like I'm feeling reluctant to give, then I don't. Seriously, I don't. I go with what I feel God is saying to me always, or you try to, but I never give reluctantly because I don't want it to produce bad fruit inside of me. Do you guys know what I'm saying? I don't want to look back. I remember one time I was in Bogota, Colombia with my mother, and in Colombia, baby, they take up offerings, let me tell you. There's a church of 400,000 people, and they take up offerings. And I think I was 19, 20 years old, and I had about $200 American in my pocket. And I'm like, God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to give you everything. And it was a really strong offering message. So I gave him everything. And afterward, I felt, oh, what did I just do? And I walked outside, and the Lord said, what'd you do that for? And I said, God, I just trust you. He said, yeah, but now you have no money to buy, like, lunch. And God spoke to me and said, I didn't tell you to do that. That was you. You did that out of compulsion. So then I had to go to, thank God my mom was with me. Do you remember that? My mom was with me, and I'm like, Mom, I have no money. She's like, what happened? You had all your money. I said, I gave it in the offering. She's like, oh, now I got to pay for you for the whole trip. And so she ended up paying for me for the whole trip. So I learned a great lesson. I give as the Lord leads me, but I also give with principled intention. So what does that mean? Since I got saved, I've always given God 10% of my income. Since the moment I got saved. And I believe that's one reason I've never lacked. Now, you can argue it any way, but if you really read the Word, you see this principle as truth. You see God taking care. If you read in Malachi chapter 3, God says that he will pour out a blessing and open the doors of heaven to those who are faithful to give him, to give him tithes and offerings. And the reason why is this, is because so many of our hearts are so connected to our money. Can you just wave to me if you love your money? Who here loves their money? You guys are lying to me right now. Something to say. You know, I say, if I put up my hand, it's a trick question. It's not a trick question. Who here's like, I love my money? Come on. I love my money. Yo, come on. Nobody here loves money. And yet, 25% of you tithe. You know, God loves you either way. He loves you. And he doesn't love you more if you tithe. But what the principle is you begin to partner with heaven and you begin to partner with God.
Yeah.
And you begin to sow seed in the form of money and time and service into the kingdom of God. And God says, you're going to reap the reward of that.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Where were we?
I know I'm preaching a long offering message, but I feel like we need this.
Because when I asked you before, who here is in need, all these hands went up. And then it's so amazing, as soon as you start talking about money, everyone gets real quiet. Awesome. You just gotta do it though. So look at this, verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. I want to be that guy. As it is written, the godly man has distributed freely, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Verse 10, he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. Who here wants this to be them? I mean, this is the word of God. I'm not making this up. This is the Bible. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing. So I'm in a season of blessing right now, financially. But I recognize it's not for me only. Amen? God has multiplied my seed so that I can sow more. Are you guys catching this? He's multiplied my seed so that I can sow more. Carly won't like this, but she might. But yesterday I was thinking to myself, I was meditating and thinking, and I'm like, who can I bless $1,000 with? Who, God, is there anyone? And I'm thinking along these lines, I'm like, God, I want to give away $1,000. I just tell you that because I'm like on the sowing seed train.
Now. Yeah.
I tell you, and you're not getting me off of it. Because the more that I give, you know, my pastor taught me years ago, he said, if you have a need, sow a seed. And I hear these stories about, you know, one of the pastors we look up to, Stephen Furtick, he'd saved $5,000 for his house, and God's told, not man, he wasn't compulsive, but nobody forced him to do it, but God spoke to him and says, you know that $5,000 that you saved up for like 3 years to for a down payment on your house? Sow it. Give it away to these people. And so he did it. Stephen Furtick. And now he's getting all this crazy. Now he lives in a $1.5 million house. And people are like, oh, pastor shouldn't do that. But he does and whatever. Whoever knows about that, who cares? But the point is, he's on the seed sowing train. Who wants to be on that train? Okay. See, because we look at stuff so naturally. Like as believers, we become carnally minded. And we don't think along these lines. I'm trying to help you this morning. Because actually, we're doing really well. Like as a church, it's a great testimony. We're doing very well financially. We don't actually need bigger offerings. We don't need. But what we need is for our people to be so victorious in their lives and in their finances. And we need people to be, we need us to be so generous that we just obey God with our money. And we're faithful with the little stuff. You know what Jesus says in the Gospels? He says, how can you be faithful with spiritual wealth if you're not faithful with natural wealth?
Yeah.
It's something to think about. Verse 11, you will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. That's what I want to be. I want to be, say, well, it's not about money. It's not about money. It's about the kingdom.
Yeah.
But if I'm rich in every way, I can be generous in every way. And our church could be a great blessing to this city. You know what this city needs? We just need to build a rehabilitation center.
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be awesome if the church had enough money to just build a rehabilitation center in this city?
Yeah.
Because there's so many people that need help.
Yeah.
But the city can't afford it. The city's in debt. Most people are in debt. Most believers are in debt.
Yeah.
The other thing I did, I've always been a giver, and then I've always been a budgeter. I tell you, not always, but for the last 8 years, I sit down and my wife and I sit down at the beginning of the month, and we meticulously write out our whole budget. I can teach you how to do that, and I'm just offering to do that. If there's anyone in this church that you say, I need help with my money, I will sit down with you for an hour and teach you how to make a budget for yourself. Or we can do a class or something. But seriously, like, I will do that. What are you going to charge me? Nothing, because I want to help you. I'm going to charge you anything to help you. I'm a pastor. This is what we do. Amen?
Amen.
So I've just put that out there. Give and be intentional. Amen?
Amen?
So I felt to share that this morning. I really, you know... And if this kind of thing chases you out of the church, then, you know, so be it. I just got to teach you what the Word of God says. It says, be faithful with your finances. Amen. Father, we just thank you in Jesus' name. Let's take up the offering. Father, we thank you in Jesus' name. And I thank you that there's no pressure in this place. There's no pressure in this church to give money. But Lord, that there is I pray that you would speak to hearts and that you give revelation on giving in Jesus' name. So you can take up your offering, and then we're going to let the kids go.